Welcome back to the channel. I have a question for you. What kind of a typist are you? Are you a perfectionist? Or do you embrace the imperfection? Does every word have to be properly spelled? Every character precisely imprinted? Every line precisely spaced? Every margin precisely lined up? Or does it matter to you, especially if you're writing for yourself? That's what I'd like to discuss today, embracing imperfection. Stay tuned. This started out last weekend. I was with Kevin down at the Albuquerque Press Club with my Skywriter, and I was having a good time writing a stream of consciousness typewritten journal entry. And I started to not care as much as I normally do about typographical errors, misstrikes, mistypings, and having to correct them. I decided after decades of being overly concerned about perfect typing that maybe if I was writing for myself, it just wouldn't matter that much. And the other night, I was lying in bed thinking about these things, and this morning decided to sit down and type up some thoughts. And even as I was typing those thoughts up, I was actually making less than perfect type, realizing that those very same misstrikes and typographical errors were present in the very notes I was making. And yet it mattered little or nothing to the fact that I could still read it perfectly legible. I could understand the thoughts contained therein. And so this morning I started rereading that typed piece from last week's Skywriter at the Press Club journal article, and I started to notice patterns of mistypings, and I started to categorize them. And I thought that was pretty amazing that you could actually categorize mistypings. And that's where this whole idea came from. So I encourage you, come along with me as I embrace the imperfections. The more I thought about it, the more remarkable it became, the idea that there are specific categories of sloppiness within typing. It's not all randomness. For instance, there are simple typographical errors, misstruck letters, improper letters, misspellings. But normally the imprint is okay. Here's an example of a simple typographical error. The word tempering, the N and the G are inverted. And then there are misstruck characters, keys that are struck with improper technique, improper force. Your fingers don't strike the center of the key. Oftentimes the imprint is fainter than normal, or sometimes there's a slight spacing problem between that character and the next one. Here's an example of a misstruck character causing the H in the word the to be fainter than usual. Here, the word relish, the I has been misstruck, actually double struck. There's a faint ghosting of the I next to it, not fully spaced, but half spaced. And then there are multiple keystrokes where a secondary key is struck midway through the keystroke of the primary key. This is usually caused by the finger being well off center of the proper key. And it usually makes a ghost character of a secondary type character, or sometimes, depending on the machine, it can cause a half spacing to happen between the primary character and the secondary character. If the multiple keystrokes happen near the edge of the keyboard, sometimes the shift key can be partially struck as the secondary key, and this might cause a vertical misalignment of the primary character, where the primary character is lower vertically than it should be. This lower A in the word parts is most likely caused by partially hitting the shift key while the A key is being printed, and this partially shifts the typewriter so the lowercase a is now too low. You'll notice in the word characters, the shift key was partially hit while the A was being typed so severely that not only is the lowercase a really low, but you can see the faint imprint of an uppercase A above the C. This is an extreme example of double hitting the shift key while typing a primary character. And then there is partial shifting, where the shift key is not pushed fully downward, and the capital letter, the shifted character, floats too high above the typing line. Here's an example of partial shifting. This is where the shift key is not pushed fully down before starting to type the character, in which case it makes the uppercase character print too high on the line. And then there are typeovers. This is a purposeful method of making corrections by simply overtyping the errant character with a bolder imprint of the correct character. Typeovers are often the easiest way to make a correction. In this case, the K of the word works has overtyped an incorrect character previously printed and done so with more striking boldness in an attempt to obscure the errant character. And then there are missing letters. This is misspelling by the omission of a character in a word. But the words are often still readable, however. Here you see the U in gourmet is missing. And then there are errant spaces. This can sometimes be operator-induced, but often is caused by a machine problem being exacerbated by improper technique. Sometimes extra spaces can be a problem with the machine skipping, but in this case, an A was double struck and then an error was typed after it, which was corrected with correction tape. But after the correction tape application, I misspaced an extra space between the word A and the word member. And then there are crowded spacings. Sometimes this is machine related, other times it's simply improper technique or a combination of both. A staccato type of typing rhythm or arrhythm can cause crowded spacing oftentimes. Sometimes crowded spacing can be caused by a mechanical problem in the typewriter that's exacerbated by improper typing technique. Here we see the W and the I are crowded together, caused most likely by my staccato typing method, exacerbating an intermittent problem with the letter I. Some problems are repetitive intermittently, but it's difficult to figure out why they happen. For instance, here, the E of where is elevated above the typing line, and it happens right after a capital letter has been typed. And again, this happens in another place in the same typing. Here is the second place this same phenomenon happens, with two entirely different characters. The R is elevated above the line after a capital letter is typed. Strange, yet repetitive, intermittently so. It wasn't until years after I'd started collecting typewriters that I began thinking about my own personal history with typewriters. I've always had, I think, a more formal relationship with typewriters. My earliest usage was, of course, in high school in typing class, and that was always a more formal relationship because the quality of text had to be as good as possible. But even afterwards, when I began using an IBM Selectric 2 while enlisted in the U.S. Navy, I noticed, looking back on it, that I had a very formal relationship with the typewriter. My purpose for using an electric typewriter was to get as formal and professional looking of an imprint as possible. It was my own personal way of self-publishing. And afterwards, in the early to mid-1980s, I continued that with a Smith Corona SE100 Daisy Wheel electronic typewriter, chosen specifically for the same reason, because of the quality of imprint that it made and the ability to correct on the page. So I've always had this formal relationship with typewriters, and it wasn't until really recently that I've come to appreciate the more organic nature of what you might call sloppy typing. I like to think about typewriting in comparison to handwriting. The analogy might be the more formal approach to handwriting would be calligraphy, a extremely neat and formal method of handwriting. But for my purposes, handwriting and private typing is always associated with spontaneous, spur-of-the-moment, impromptu recording of thoughts on paper, and oftentimes that has to take place as rapidly as possible in order to keep up with the speed of thought. And so I find that sloppy handwriting is easy to do. In my case, most of my handwriting is sloppy. I have to purposefully write every letter neatly in order to not be sloppy, in which case it's not a very efficient method of recording one's thoughts in a timely manner. So I find sloppy typing is much more legible than sloppy handwriting or the handwriting of another person you're unfamiliar with, in which case the letters can be entirely unreadable. It can look like hieroglyphs. But with sloppy typing, every character is printed from a molded cast type slug that is well formed. And there are only specific ways in which the characters can be misprinted or sloppily printed. And so they're oftentimes the sloppiest typing is still readable, or the intent is still readable. I think about perusing the stacks of papers that are collected after a public typewriter event has concluded. And I enjoy sitting down afterwards and sifting through those pages and discovering the hidden joys contained within. And oftentimes it'll be lines of illegible, seemingly random characters, clusters of such random characters, and then all of a sudden in the midst of that will be a partial phrase or partial sentence of legibility, just jumping out off the page from the background of random typings. And then it continues onward after that with more random clusters of letters. The human mind is well suited to picking out patterns from backgrounds of seeming randomness. It's probably programmed in our genetics and our biology. And that's what I find is amazing about reading sloppy typing, is it is so legible. Sometimes overly proper typing can appear to be an affectation. I know in many cases it has been for me, especially writings which are intended to be entirely private, my private typewritten journal entries. I will oftentimes pause, backspace, retype a too faint character, or pull out the correction tape and correct a mistyping right on the spot. Why do I do that? No one else is going to read that but me. Why is it important for me to think of myself as a perfect typist, when perhaps it's better to let the spontaneous mistypings happen as they come and let that be a document of the process, the earliest stages of the writing process? I've seen a number of typewriter bloggers lately who seem to produce wonderful typings that are less than pristine from a strictly mechanical point of view. And one of those typists who I really enjoy his work is Vinnie McFeats of the Untimely Typewriter blog. And there is a recent article of his that I absolutely love the look of this piece because of the way he's corrected letters, overprinted some letters, typed in red ink, corrections above and between the lines, and other techniques, strikeouts. I just love the way he uses the typewriter in an organic fashion to produce entirely readable, legible, well-written pieces that are entirely first drafts and yet they are beautiful in the sense of being able to see the painter's brush marks or being able to see the sculptor's fingerprint marks in the finished work. I think there's an entirely organic quality to this that I've missed on in the past and I appreciate now. So where would the painting be without the brush strokes, the evidence of the artist's handiwork? Where would the sculpture be without the impressions of his fingerprints in the clay? This is a revelation to me in a way, because I haven't really thought about it before, how the mechanics of the writing process can impact themselves upon the rough draft that we perform in private. And I think it's a freeing thing to be able to express those pieces publicly or to other people. I certainly have not been able to do that in the past. And I'm curious about you. What do you think about less than perfect typing? Have you embraced the imperfections? Let me know down below. Drop a comment. I'd love to hear from you. Until next time, stay creative and have yourselves a great day. Bye-bye for now.